Good morning. We are glad, so very glad that you are here and you're able to join us. Welcome to the Aurora Vineyard. We have finished up a series recently on how we were shaped. That series called Wired. And so now we're going to do what we're going to call a couple small batch sermons. And so it dawned on me as I was walking up the aisle this morning, right down the bottom corner here, there's a store that sells soap and all kinds of stuff. And on the window, it says small batch soap. I've never heard of small batch soap before. I don't know what's better than big batch soap. But, you know, there's small batch soap, there's small batch bourbon, there's small batch all kinds of other stuff. So between now and Easter, we're going to just do some small batch sermons. And this morning, not to give away what we'll do for Easter, but we're going to build to that, kind of starting today in the narrative of Jesus specifically. And I'm going to read a list to you this morning. Before I do that, I should probably pray. I'm going to read a list to you here in a second, and then I'm going to ask you what this list has in common. So let's pray together first. Father, we thank you so much that we get to be with you this morning. Father, I pray that you would hide me behind the cross of Jesus so that you were seen and heard. Father, because you have a marvelous way, unique way, wonderful way of taking your word and putting it into our hearts to change us. So, Father, give us ears and hearts and minds to be changed this morning. We love you so much, and we thank you for what you will do in us. And all God's people said, okay. I'm going to read a list to you, and this is a list from, this is a list of 10 things, and they're from least to worst, best to worst, okay? All right. Now, some of you will recognize almost everything on this list, and if you do, we are probably going to be friends the rest of our lives. If you do not recognize anything on this list, you're dead to me. Now, number 10 is Never Gonna Give You Up by Rick Astley. You know that song? Never Gonna Give You Up. Right, okay. Number 9 is Putting on the Ritz by Taco. Yes. Number 8 is Mickey by Tony Basil. Sing it, Steph. Right. Oh, Mickey, you're so fine, right?
These are the worst songs of the 80s.
Yes, I know. No, I didn't forget. I was going to ask them later. But thank you for throwing me under the bus, Paul. Just so you know, this is the worst list of songs from the 1980s. Thank you, Paul. Number 7 is Don't Worry, Be Happy by Bobby McFerrin. Number 6 is Rock Me Amadeus. Yes? By Falco. Love that song. I turn it up every time it comes on. That was a song I drove to high school to. Number 5 is Safety Dance by Men Without Hats. Yes? I know. Number 4 is Wake Me Up by Wham. Wake me up, right? Number 3 is Lady in Red. This was the most obscure one in all of this. Lady in Red by Christa Berg. Number 2 is Final Countdown by Europe. And allegedly, the worst song of the entire decade of the 80s is We Built This City by Starship. We built this city, right, on rock and roll, right. It's about San Francisco, actually. Now, the odd thing about this list is, well, the number 1 especially, you know, before they were Starship, they were Jefferson Starship. And before they were Jefferson Starship, they were Jefferson Airplane, which I bet some of Jefferson Airplane's music is on the top 10 best songs of the 70s. Okay, so I have no idea how you figure out what the worst songs are. We can figure out the best were because of rankings and all kinds of stuff, how many albums they sold. But this is the worst, this list says that they are the worst songs of the 80s, and I love every one of them. I could sing most of them right now. I could probably give you the lyrics of most of these songs just off the top of my head. Now, imagine if you were, oh, let's say Rick Astley, because he's the number 10. So let's say you're Never Gonna Give You Up. He hears that his song is the 10th worst song of an entire decade. How do you do that? Now, last summer, I got to see Rick Springfield in concert. Great concert. He's 64, maybe a little bit older than that. Great concert. Yeah, young guy. But can you imagine being one of these people in this list and hearing somebody, some group of people say, oh, that song that was a big hit for you, that's one of the worst of a decade. How is that okay? How is that fair? Because this group of people put a lot of time and energy and their talents and abilities only for someone to say, yeah, that was horrible. Don't do that again. How do you manage that? How does that feel and when it comes to thinking about what's fair? It doesn't sound fair at all. So this morning, we're going to talk about when life isn't fair. And if you've lived long enough, you've had enough experiences, you have seen parts of your life that just weren't fair. Why does somebody else get this and I didn't? Why is somebody else's life working out and mine is not? Why did somebody else get this and I got that? And it doesn't feel fair. So, when life isn't fair, I must change how I see things. When life isn't fair, I must change how I see things. I can easily stay focused on what I don't have and what somebody else does, and then I begin to measure fairness. So when life isn't fair, I must change how I see things. So we're going to look at two points of view this morning. Actually, we're going to look at three points of view. And we're going to look at those from a very interesting story from the life of Jesus, which includes a part of the life of John the Baptist. And our story starts in Matthew chapter 3. But what we're going to look at is what John saw. John the Baptist, who is Jesus' second cousin. They were familiar with each other. John was a little bit older than Jesus. But what John saw, and this is very significant, what he saw. Matthew chapter 3, verses 13 to 17. Then Jesus came from Galilee to the Jordan to be baptized by John. So Jesus comes to the Jordan River where John the Baptist is baptizing people. But John tried to deter him. John tried to say, no, this isn't going to happen. I need to be baptized by you, and you come to me. Jesus replied, let it be so now. It is proper for us to fulfill all righteousness. Then John said, okay. Then John consented. So John sees Jesus coming to the Jordan to be baptized by him. And John says, this is not a good idea. I know who you are. And you are way above my pay grade. You shouldn't be baptizing me. I shouldn't be baptizing you. You should be baptizing me. And Jesus compels him and says, no, this is exactly what should happen. The baptism of Jesus starts his public ministry. He's pretty much under the radar until this moment. He's teaching. He's doing a few things that are significant. Some people are being healed. But at his baptism, his ministry amps up. So, in verse 16, as soon as Jesus was baptized, he went up out of the water. We're going to stop right there for a second, just for a quick teaching moment. Biblical baptism is immersion. It's putting somebody under the water and raising them back up, because that's the picture of the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. When Jesus died, they didn't sprinkle dirt on his head and call him buried. He went into a tomb. And he raised back up again 3 days later. Baptism is always a picture of the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. So it says after he was baptized, he came up out of the water. Why? Because he was down in it. Because that's where you go to get dipped under. The word baptized means to dip underwater. By definition, that's what it means. Right, Bob? Amen. At that moment, heaven was open. Now, this is what John the Baptist saw. At that moment, heaven was opened, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and lighting on him. And a voice from heaven said, this is my Son, whom I love. With him I am happy. With him I am well pleased. That's significant. Now, you keep in mind that John the Baptist was the first prophet in the nation of Israel in 400 years. Their entire history was God sending a prophet into their nation and saying, this is what God says to us. It was Samuel, it was Elisha, it was Elijah, it was Nathan, it was Isaiah, it was Micah, it was Nahum, it was all these great, what we know as the Old Testament characters, who told the people of Israel what God wanted, and we had to say to them. And then for 400 years, there was silence. And you not only didn't hear a prophet of God, you didn't even know anybody who had heard a prophet, because 400 years had gone by and the heavens were silent. And then 30 years ago, angels start showing up and talking to Mary and to Joseph and to different people and saying, hey, the Messiah's coming, the Messiah's coming, the Messiah's coming, and quoting the Old Testament prophets like Isaiah and Micah, and this is how they knew who Jesus was going to be. And so John the Baptist shows up, and he's nuts. He's off the hook. He doesn't preach in golf shorts. He preaches in clothes made from camel hair, right? He's eating honey and bugs. He is not on TV. He is not well-dressed. He is not well-groomed. His hair is not cut and his beard is not shaved. He is wild. As soon as Jesus was baptized, he went up out of the water. And everybody around, including John, this is what John the Baptist saw. The Holy Spirit in the form of a dove coming on Jesus and a voice from heaven saying, I love my son. And I am well pleased in him. This is what John saw. This is significant. John saw what very few people, other people saw. John chapter 1. Now, this is not John the Baptist writing this. This is John the disciple writing this. The next day, John saw Jesus. This is an account of the same story. John saw Jesus coming toward him and said, look. John the Baptist was such a phenomenon, he had a lot of people following him all the time. When Jesus comes to get baptized, John puts all the attention on Jesus. He says, stop looking at me, look at him. Look, the Lamb of God who will take away the sin of the world. This is what John the Baptist saw. This is the one I meant when I said, a man who comes after me has surpassed me. Because he was before me. Let's stay right there because that sounds confusing. The one who comes after me is greater than I am because he was before me. Wait, you just said he came after you. How can he be before you? John the Baptist knew that Jesus was God. That's how he can say it. The one who's coming, he has excelled beyond me and he was before me. Now, John the Baptist was older than Jesus. So what John was really saying was, this is Jesus, this is God, this is the Messiah. I myself did not know him, but the reason I came baptizing with water was that he might be revealed to Israel. I'm doing what I'm doing to point you to Jesus. That's what John saw, and that's fantastic. That's what John saw. Now, let's talk about what John sees. Because what John sees seems to be in conflict with what he saw. Matthew chapter 11, verses 1 to 3. After Jesus had finished instructing his 12 disciples, he went from there to teach and preach in the towns of Galilee. When John heard in prison what Christ was doing, let's stay right there. So John the Baptist goes from being this preaching celebrity to being in jail. So what John sees now are prison bars. He does not see crowds of people coming to listen to him preach. He does not see crowds of people that are coming to be baptized. He doesn't see that anymore. He sees prison bars. So he still has followers. And he sends these followers to Jesus. When John heard in prison what Christ was doing, he sent his disciples to ask him, are you the one? Are you him? I mean, I remember seeing you and saying, "Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." That's what I saw. But what I see now is I'm in prison. And are you the one who is to come? Or should we expect somebody else? See, because this doesn't feel fair. Remember me, Jesus? Our moms were cousins. Remember me? I'm the one who said, "Hey, look at him. Remember me?" So are you him? Or should we keep looking? Because this doesn't feel fair. Why is somebody else's life working out and mine is not? Why is somebody else's marriage getting fixed and mine is not? Why can't I make my wife love me? Why can't I make my husband give me attention? Why are my kids not getting their act right? Why? Because this doesn't feel fair, and I don't like it. So, are you him, or should I keep looking for somebody else? Because this isn't fair. So this is what Jesus gets questioned. And of course, you know the story. He goes, "Oh my goodness, John, I didn't know you were in jail. Let me drop everything I'm doing and run over there." No. Matthew chapter 11, verses 4 or 5. Jesus replies to the question, "Are you him?" He doesn't say, "Yes, I am." He says, "Go back and report to John what you hear and see. The blind receive sight, the lame walk. Those who had leprosy are cured. The deaf hear, the dead are raised, and the good news is preached to the poor." Yeah, but John can see, and John isn't crippled, and John doesn't have leprosy, and John isn't dead, and John knows the good news. But John's in prison. Do you see the only thing missing from that list? How about a jailbreak, Jesus? Just come, bring some people, bust me out. It's not on the list. So what do they see? They see that the blind can see. They see that the lame can walk. They see that lepers are cured. They see that deaf people can now hear. They see that those who are dead are raised from the dead. And they see that God's news, the good news of the gospel, is preached to the poor. But Jesus, I'm none of those and I'm in jail. Why aren't you fixing what's wrong with my life? Why aren't you rescuing me from my problems? Why aren't you helping my situation? So are you really him, or should we keep looking? This is what John sees now. Isn't it interesting? He goes from in just a few years, "Behold the Lamb of God who will take away the sin of the world," to, "Are you really him? Because following you isn't working out for me. Why do I have these problems, but they don't? Why is my life hard, but their life seems easy? Why do they get this and I don't? Why did they find a spouse, but I haven't? Why is their life working out and mine isn't?" This is what John sees. So what does Jesus see? I think this is probably the most significant point we have to come to, is that we need to change how we see things. So what does Jesus see? Matthew chapter 11, verses 7 to 19. Now remember, Jesus is talking to a bunch of people. John's disciples have come over and said, "Are you him? Are you the real deal? Or should John wants to know if we should keep on looking?" And Jesus answers, "Go back and tell John everything you've seen." As John's disciples were leaving, Jesus began to speak to the crowd about John. Pay attention, because I think it's fundamental when life isn't fair that we see the way Jesus sees. What did you go out into the desert to see? Now, he's talking about John the Baptist. Remember, he's a wild man, hair, beard, not the most fashionable guy, eating honey and bugs. What did you go out to see? A reed swayed by the wind. Did you go out to see a weakling? Did you go out to see somebody that had no place to stand, that was blown by this idea and blown by that idea? Is that what you went out to see? Somebody that was fickle? If not, what did you go out to see? A man dressed in fine clothes? No, those who wear fine clothes are in king's palaces. Then what did you go out to see? I love that Jesus is direct. What did you go out to see? Somebody who didn't stand for anything? Somebody who was a coward? Somebody who would say hard things? Is that what you went out to see? Did you go out to see somebody who was dressed really nice because that made you feel good about being in the right church? Huh? So when life wasn't working out, you begin to question. So some of you came to a church that you knew everybody. It was nice to know everybody, and that gave you a certain feeling. And you know, there's only two kinds of churches, those who are dying and those who are growing. There's no plateauing. So you're in a church that's actually growing, that loves to see people come to Jesus Christ, and we're doing two services. And some people don't like that. You can't have it both ways. You either come to a church that grows and cares about people getting to heaven and discipling those people, or you go to a church that's dying, and you'll know everybody. You just happen to know a bunch of dying people. That's it, Marty. So welcome to a church that cares about people going to heaven. We will continue to grow. We will continue to be as many services we have to fit people into this place. And when we hit 80% full, then we add more services. That's what we do. Because people need to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ, and we will make room for them. And I'll be as transparent and as honest as I can. They are more important than I am. They are more important than I am. The fact that we make room for somebody, and if I have to sit somewhere else or have to move in and move up, which is what we should all do on Easter, we move in and we move up. Because new people won't sit in the front row. Because I spit when I preach. And I can reach them from here. Right here, I can reach them. So welcome people into this fellowship. Welcome your friends and your family and your neighbors into this place, because they need to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ, and they need discipled, and they need you to care enough to bring them. And knowing that in this place, we'll make room for them. Because Jesus loves them too. So what did you go out to see? Did you go out to feel comfortable? Did you go out to just feel warm and fuzzy? And how far did that get you? No, he says, you went out to see a prophet. And a lot more than that. So for John, purpose was much more important than his image. This is who I'm made to be. This is what I'm made to do. And it was more important than his image, because he didn't smell good. Dude, you don't live out in the desert and smell nice. You just don't. A couple weeks ago, I was blessed to be in Florida visiting some friends and got to play a little golf. And sometimes in our lives, things don't work out the way we think they should. And so because it was just Dan and I, we got paired up with other people every day, the 3 days we played. One day we get paired up with this guy named Domingo Torres. Now, just so you know, he's Hispanic. He's from Chile. And I know he's from Chile because I'll tell you why. So as we play, you know, it's always a mix. You never know who you're going to end up with. He was a good golfer, played quick until this moment. How do you guys know each other? Oh, we played the same club up in Kentucky. Oh, okay. What do you do for a living? Now, this is one of two things that happen. I'm a pastor. Okay, at that moment, either they go away or they come close. It's rarely ever neutral. And so he said, oh, really? What kind of church? I said, it's a Vineyard church in Aurora, Indiana. I'm a Vineyard worship leader. And I went, oh, no. nice guy, nice as could be. I hope he doesn't see this because I really enjoyed meeting him, but he did not shut up. Just talked nonstop. Well, do you know that? And he's naming all kinds of big names in the Vineyard movement. Oh, did you know them? Did you know them? I'm like, no. I got a hit. No. It's you're up. Tee up your ball and hit. No. And just constant. At one point, he's leaning on my cart this close to my face. And he's just telling me this story and that story. And he used to plant Vineyard churches in Chile. A very funny story. They invited him to come to a meeting, and he said, no gringos. He said, I won't come if there's gringos there, us, white folks. He said, no. And they convinced him to go, and he was like, oh, how wrong I was. If these people want to worship Jesus, then I had to be a part of worshiping Jesus. So he tells me a story, and he's hanging on my cart. And finally, we have to drive off, and he won't. So as he finally lets go of the cart, because if not, we're going to drag him up the cart path. The guy I'm with, the guy I stayed with, I was in Florida, he looks over and he goes, I hate you. And I'm like, dude, I can't help it. It's just is what it is. That's not what I anticipated, and it made the round longer. And because sometimes I don't want to be on stage. Sometimes I just want to be on my motorcycle. Sometimes I just want to be on the golf course. Sometimes I just want to be and not be on. And God says, well, that's great that you want that. And if you don't think it's fair that you don't get to go relax, I'm not really interested in that. I'm interested in you fulfilling your purpose. And your image gets way, way down there because your purpose is more important than your image. Jesus goes on about John. He says, this is the one whom it is written, I will send my messenger ahead of you who will prepare the way before you. This is John the Baptist preparing the way of Jesus. He says, I tell you the truth, among those born of women, there is not risen anyone greater than John the Baptist. Remember, this is what Jesus sees. John is sitting in prison feeling sorry for himself, and Jesus tells everybody, there is no one ever greater than John the Baptist. That's what Jesus sees in John. It's interesting. Because when we are down and we are sad and we are depressed and we are hurting and we're feeling sorry for ourselves because somebody else's life is working out in our minds better than ours is working out, we don't see ourselves the way Jesus sees us. But see, I made you and I shaped you to be you. Don't worry about what anybody else is doing. You do you. You serve. You give your life away. You obey. You do the right thing. Yeah, you feel like you're sitting in prison. And all the while, Jesus is going, yeah, but there's nobody greater than John the Baptist. Wow. And as sorry as we can feel for ourselves at times, Jesus is saying, yeah, but I made you to be you. And I've anointed you. And my hand is on you. And yeah, you feel like you're sitting in prison. And you feel hopeless and you feel desperate. But in the eyes of Jesus, you're the greatest you there ever is. There's no greater you than you. Yet he who is least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than John. That seems interesting, doesn't it? Nobody ever greater than John, born of women. But everybody who's less than John is greater than John. Our perspective sometimes is so messed up. We look at the wrong things so often. From the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of heaven has been forcefully advancing and forceful men lay hold of it. Let's stay right there for a second. The kingdom of God has been moving forcefully. This statement, the kingdom work is not for the faint of heart. It's just not. It's going to be tough to look at things from God's perspective. It's going to be tough to sacrifice. It's going to be difficult to look around and say, okay, my life doesn't look like their life, but that doesn't mean that God is not working in my life. My situation may feel desperate and I'm in prison, sometimes of my own making, but God is working in my life. And it's a battle worth fighting. In 1932, Australia waged a war. I don't know if you knew this or not. They waged a war on their own continent. And this is a true story. You can look this up. They waged a war. The Australian army went to war against emus. the big flightless bird that looked kind of like an ostrich. They went to war against birds. This is a true story. The continent, part of the continent, was overrun with these birds, destroying crops and everything. So the Australian Army gets three of their soldiers, arms them with automatic weapons, and sends them to fight emus. A lot of them. I can't make this up. Over 20,000 emus. They send out three soldiers with heavy artillery to kill 20,000 emus. Now, the Australian Army lost. It's a true story. And that was just the first battle. There were other wars. There's at least two other times where they did the same thing. And they lost all the time. And you would think, okay, look, we have allegedly superior intellect and superior firepower. It was such a colossal failure that globally the nation of Australia got ridiculed. Like, wait, you lost a war to birds. Because the birds were very instinctual and they were very clever. And they figured out, like, okay, when we see these vehicles coming, they just scatter. And the success rate was so small that they ultimately gave up. Now, you would imagine with superior firepower and superior intellect, they could get something done. But how often do we, in our lives, with superior intellect, knowing what we know about God, fail miserably? We know the right thing to do. The Apostle Paul said, the stuff I want to do, I never end up doing. And the stuff I don't want to do, somehow I end up committing those sins. Knowing all the while that that hurts us, that keeps us enslaved, all of that stuff. He says the kingdom of God is not for the faint of heart. So when you begin to obey and you begin to launch out and do right and obey and follow the Lord, it's going to be tough. It's going to be tough. And you may end up feeling like those three soldiers. Can you imagine every day going home and sitting down at dinner and going, well, honey, how was work today? Did you kill any emus? I mean, there were 20,000 of them out there. And you're going, yeah, it was a little rough today. They're smarter than what we thought. Yeah. Verse 13 says, for all the prophets in the law prophesied until John. Now you remember 400 years, so these people are looking back to prophecies. And if you are willing to accept it, he is the Elijah who is to come. He hears to ears, let him hear. So Elijah came before Elisha in the Old Testament, two very significant prophets. And Jesus very clearly says he was Elijah. He was the prophet that came before Elisha, and I'm the new one. John the Baptist came to get you ready for me. Maybe you can hear that, maybe you can't. Verse 16, he says, to what do I compare this generation? They're like children sitting in the marketplaces calling out to others, we played the flute for you, and you didn't dance. We sang a dirge for you, and you didn't mourn. John the Baptist, you should have come entertaining us. Make us feel good about ourselves. Let me tell you why you should feel good about yourself. To start, there's a God in heaven who loved you so much that he gave up the thing he loved the most, which was his son, Jesus Christ, and he gave up his son so he would die on the cross for you so that you could have a relationship with the God of heaven, and when you leave this world someday, you will go to heaven and be with God forever. That's why you're valuable. That's it. That's where your value starts. That's it. So, John, they weren't happy with John. Would you go out to sea? You know, we played music for you and you just didn't do what we wanted. You didn't make us feel warm and fuzzy. You didn't tell us all the stuff we wanted to hear. Verse 18, for John came neither eating or drinking, and you say he has a demon. Huh. So he lived a different life than you, and you ridiculed him for it. Then verse 19, the Son of Man came eating and drinking, and they say he's a glutton and a drunkard. You can't win. You can't win. John was this, and you didn't like him, and then Jesus came and wasn't doing that, and you don't like him either. So what will it take to make you happy? That's what he's getting at. You say he's a friend of tax collectors and sinners. Those are some great friends. Some great friends. And here's why. Because when those people come to faith in Jesus, they know what they were saved from. They know what they were delivered from. They know, I once was lost, but now am found, was blind, but now I see. They know the story of being a prodigal. They know the story of rebellion and sin and selfishness, and they know they were saved from that. And wisdom is proved right by her actions. So I'm going to leave you with this statement. If I refuse to change how I see things, if all I ever choose to see are my bars and how bad my life is and how great I think somebody else's life is, if I refuse to change how I see things, I will never, ever grow. I'll never, ever change. And I'll never be all in for the kingdom of God. If all I do is sit in my prison and stare at the bars and think somebody else is getting a life better than I'm getting, I'm never going to grow. I'm never going to learn the lesson that I should be learning. I'm never going to change. I'm never going to be all in for the kingdom of God. I believe you are the exact opposite of that. I really mean that. I believe all of you look around and you go, no, God is good. This is hard, but God is good. And so you're willing to be all in. You're willing to change how you see things. You're willing to own your stuff and accept responsibility and say, God, you want more from me than I can ever imagine I would even want for myself. And so you'll change and you'll grow and you'll be all in. Let's pray together. Father, thank you so much for your love for us. Thank you so much for the transparency of Scripture, where we hear about John the Baptist, who is fantastic, and yet he struggled. He struggled with his own situation of his life. He struggled with his own perspectives. He struggled in his faith. And yet you see him through eyes of mercy and grace and love. And thank you that you see us through those same eyes. Father, we love you and we thank you for what you'll do with us and in us and through us. You are so, so good. We love you and we thank you. And in Jesus' name, we all said, amen. So let me...